Welcome to Stories from the NNI. I'm Lisa Friedersdorf, Director of the National Nanotechnology Coordination Office. Today, it's my pleasure to welcome Jessica Winter, Professor of Biomedical Engineering and Chemical and Biomolecular Engineering at Ohio State University. Jessica, thank you so much for joining us today. To get us started, could you just tell us a little bit about yourself and how you got involved in nanotechnology?
Yeah, thank you very much for having me. So I actually worked after I finished my bachelor's degree in chemical engineering at Intel. So I was involved in nanotechnology kind of from the beginning. And after a couple of years at Intel, I decided I really wanted to do research. And I went back to graduate school to get my PhD. And I wanted to work in nanotech because I was kind of bored in industry. Not that Intel's not a great company, it's fabulous, but being a process engineer wasn't for me. And I wanted to work on some of the most challenging problems that we're facing. And the idea of working with materials that I can't actually touch or see sounded really exciting to me. And so I decided to go into that area. And particularly, I work in bio-nanotechnology, which is the application of nanotechnology to biology, which is definitely one of the hardest challenges out there because we don't really understand biology very well.
Can you tell us a little bit about your work on quantum dot imaging?
So quantum dots are nanoparticles that are made of semiconductors, the same materials that would be in a computer chip, for example. And they have the unique property that they fluoresce, which most people would understand best as kind of glow in the dark, like your t-shirt or something. So when I shine light on them, they will emit light of a different color. And that makes them really good for biological labeling, which is important in diagnostics so that I can identify different proteins that, or even DNA that a cell might be expressing that allows me to link it to a specific disease condition. So quantum dots were first discovered in the early 80s, but didn't really come to the forefront for imaging until 1998, when there were two papers in Science, one by Paul Olivisatos's group and one by Shuming Ni's group. I started my graduate career in 1999, so inspired by those papers, we decided to see if we could use quantum dots for biological imaging of live cells, which at that time had not yet been done. And that kind of got me in the field.
Can you talk a little bit about why you would want to do that and what potential applications there are?
Cell labeling is a really important component of both clinical diagnostics and biological research. So on the diagnostic side, one of the easiest examples for people to understand is the staining that you might get if you were having pathology done for cancer. So for example, for breast cancer, we measure three different labels: estrogen receptor, progesterone receptor, and HER2, which is human epidermal growth factor receptor 2. And depending on which of those three a patient has, they would receive different therapy, different drugs. So in order to find those labels, often we use a fluorescent label. And this could be a quantum dot, but we also have molecular dyes, which are just chemical molecules that have the same function. And we want to label the cell to see if that marker is there to match the patient to the therapy. Alternatively, for biological research, we use fluorescent labels to understand which proteins or DNA, RNA molecules are expressed and where they are expressed in the cell. And that allows us to study cell signaling pathways and cell-cell communication, cell migration, cell proliferation, and basically understand all the functions of the cell by lighting up different components and understanding how they interact together to get an end result.
So I want to switch gears a little bit and talk a little bit about the nature of the research that you do. I mean, you describe the application, you talked a little bit about using quantum dots or molecular dyes to do the imaging, but it seems like the combination of biology and materials and chemistry would bring together people from different backgrounds. Could you talk about collaboration and interdisciplinarity in your work?
Sure. Nearly all of the research that I do is interdisciplinary. We have a lot of different players involved. Because I'm working in biology, And particularly trying to focus on getting products to the clinic. I have many collaborators that are practicing clinicians, mostly in the cancer field. I also collaborate with people in bioinformatics who work on image analysis and data processing, because since we're labeling all these different markers and trying to understand how they interact, we end up with rather a lot of data to sift through. I also collaborate with other types of engineers, biomedical engineer, other biomedical, other chemical engineers, mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, and with scientists in biology and chemistry. We work with lots of different people to try to understand how to put all the pieces together to get to something that will actually work and have an impact in real life.
You mentioned that you've been involved in this area for some time, and I'm wondering if we could get your perspective on the advances that have been made in nanotechnology over the past 20 years or so, and then also take a look forward and where are the areas that you're most excited about where nanotechnology might play an impact in the future?
You know, I think people often overestimate where we are in nanotechnology. I know there's conspiracy theories that we have these nanobots that are going to infect people and do stuff. And I tell people, if that were real and I could do that, I would have the Nobel Prize in the bag, right? And the truth is, we're just not there. We're not. Nanotechnology really took off after Richard Feynman's Room at the Bottom speech in the 1960s. That's often cited as the pivotal moment. But for me, in my field, nanotechnology really started to advance in the late 90s, particularly coinciding with the NNI initiative, which funneled a lot of money into this area of research. And what happened initially is people began to make more and more types of nanoparticles. So we got gold and silver, we have metals, we have semiconductor nanoparticles like quantum dots, we're able to make polymer nanoparticles, all of these different materials, magnetic nanoparticles. And we got really good at making them in our labs in a tiny beaker. And then it turned out, well, that's all great, but if I actually want to realize the potential, I have two problems. I need to make a lot of these materials, and I need to be able to integrate them with other things. And so the research has shifted a little bit. And you'll hear this term scalable nanomanufacturing, which is talking about how to make a whole bunch of something that we know how to make in the lab, but when we just try to make the beaker bigger, it doesn't work. And we need ways to be able to make kilograms of this, not micrograms. And that in itself is a whole set of challenges. But that's actually what chemical engineers do. Our main job is scaling things up. So that is a place where I personally am very comfortable and a lot of my colleagues work. The other piece, though, is integration. And I have all these nanoparticles, and sometimes they're made directly in a device through, say, molecular beam epitaxy. But other times they're made in solution, and then I need to place them in a specific location. And remembering that I can't really pick these things up because they're so small, that becomes quite a challenge. And so the field has looked at things like self-assembly and bottom-up nanomanufacturing. And this is an area where there hasn't been as much work done historically. And so there's a lot of room to research and to learn and grow. And the field has sort of been transforming in these two dimensions so that we can take all the different exciting nanoparticles that we made in the early 2000s and we can actually use them in something. So most of the commercial nanoparticle-based products right now focus on what I would call a simple mixing of two things together. For example, I mix carbon nanofiber with a polymer and I make a stronger material that now I can sell as a hockey stick or maybe part of a car body frame. But in that particular case, the location of the nanomaterial within the larger composite is not really important. If I want to make a sensor, on the other hand, I actually need the nanomaterial to lie across the two electrodes. And so placement becomes important. And that's kind of the next generation of where we're moving, is how to design products that are more complicated, where we need a lot of nanomaterials and they need to be placed very precisely within the product.
It sounds like the experience that you've had in nanotechnology research and in bio nanotechnology has taken you in a number of different directions. Do you have advice that you give students that might be interested in pursuing a career in nanotechnology?
Well, nanotechnology, even though it's now been around for some time, we're still advancing. And so, you know, I tell people to kind of be flexible and to look at where the research is and think about how to look at new ideas as they're emerging and integrate them into what we're doing. So this is a field where there's still a lot of undiscovered country, and you have to just be open to that. Also, everyone in my group, we tend to work on many different projects at once because there's a lot of chance of failure. So if I'm doing five things, three of them will work and two won't, and that's great. So I'll still have something to continue with. So I tell people basically to not be afraid to try things, to try a lot of things and not be afraid to fail, that's okay.
And I think that that's great advice. I just want to thank you again for taking the time to talk with us and ask, as we're looking at new directions for the NNI, do you have any closing thoughts that you'd like to share with our listeners?
I think the NNI has done a really important part of the maturation of the nanotechnology field. And as we move to places where the research is more established, I think the focus needs to shift towards product development. We've made all these wonderful nanoparticles, and some of them have really amazing properties. But to get them to actually have that impact is going to take a little bit more focus on the manufacturing aspects. You know, we still need to be coming up with more new and exciting materials, but we also need to now be focusing on bringing those to fruition, because I think the time is ripe.
Thank you for joining us today for the Stories from the NNI. If you would like to learn more about nanotechnology, please visit nano.gov or email us at info@nnco.nano.gov. And check back here for more stories.